I cannot tell you how the light comes. What I know is that it is more ancient than imagining, that it travels across an astounding expanse to reach us. That it loves searching out what is hidden, what is lost, what is forgotten, or in peril, or in pain. That it has a fondness for the body, for finding its way toward flesh, for tracing the edges of form, for shining forth through the eye, the hand, the heart. I cannot tell you how the light comes, but that it does, that it will, that it works its way into the deepest dark that enfolds you, though it may seem long ages in coming, or arrive in a shape you did not foresee. And so, may we this day turn ourselves toward it. May we lift our faces to let it find us. May we bend our bodies to follow the arc it makes. May we open and open more and open still to the blessed light that comes.
Thank you.
Welcome to worship with First Presbyterian Church in Richmond, Virginia, on this Christmas Eve. We are so grateful that you are joining us, and we want to extend a special welcome to any visitors who are here with us. This is often a time when we welcome friends and family to worship, and it is a gift to be able to gather together tonight from our homes and wherever we are. Be sure to subscribe to our YouTube channel and go to the church website, fpcrichmond.org, to learn more about our community and sign up to receive our weekly email newsletter. Tonight, we welcome the Raggi family, Matt, Ashley, James, Hannah, and Caroline, to light our Christ candle and call us to worship.
On Christmas Eve, we remember all the promises that have led us to this day. Each represented in the light of a candle. Hope, peace, joy, and love.
Four candles, four promises continually offered to us by God. And all of them manifest in this one we light tonight, the Christ candle.
In Christ we find the hope of transformation, the peace that follows justice, the joy of community, and the love that surrounds us in all our diversity, empowering us to make our own unique contribution to this world. In Christ we find light and life and the courage to be like him, answering his call and following in his footsteps.
As we receive again the gift of God's presence, God coming to us as one of us, no matter who we are or where we are, we remember the response of the shepherds in the field, serenaded by angels who announced the birth of a newborn king. They immediately went with haste in search of this great gift and found him with Mary and Joseph. They told what they had seen and heard and left, praising and glorifying God. And so may we respond with praise and thanksgiving, ready to share the great good news of Christ's birth.
Let us pray. Light of the world, in coming to us, you show us your way of hope, peace, joy, and love. Open our hearts to receive your presence. Open our eyes and ears that we might see and hear. The angels announce your birth this night. Inspires us to come with haste to testify to your presence. Guide us as we seek to respond to call your to love one another as you have loved us. Amen.
Amen.
Happy Christmas Eve. One of my favorite aspects of Christmas Eve is hearing the story of the birth of Jesus once again and imagining what it might have been like. Imagining angels and shepherds and stars and a newborn baby. And so tonight on this special Christmas Eve, I invite you, and not just all the children, but all of us, to hear again the story of the birth of Jesus, read by Neely Barnhart, and with these beautiful pictures by illustrator Julie Vivas. She helps us to imagine what a special night it might have been. So look carefully. What do you see on the angel's feet? And what about the face of the baby Jesus and the face of the shepherds as they peer over the manger? Tonight, on this special night, Miss Christie and I send you lots of love and wish you a Merry Christmas. Let your imagination go wild as you hear this story and take in God's love.
In the days of Herod the king, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to the city of Nazareth to a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph, and the virgin's name was Mary. And the angel said unto her, "Hail, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women." And when she saw him, she was troubled. The angel said, "Fear not, for thou hast found favor with God. Thou shalt bring forth a son and call his name Jesus. It came to pass that Caesar Augustus decreed that all the world should be taxed, every one to his own city. So Joseph went from Nazareth to the city of Bethlehem with Mary, his wife, being great with child. And so it was that while they were there, the day came that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling cloths and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. There were in that same country shepherds in the field keeping watch over their flock by night. When lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said, "Fear not, for I bring you tidings of great joy, for unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign. Ye shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling cloths, lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God. When the angels were gone, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go into Bethlehem to see this thing which has come to pass." And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. And behold, there came wise men to Jerusalem saying, "Where is he that is born King of the Jews? For we have seen his star and are come to worship him." And lo, the star which they saw in the east went before them till it stood over where the young child was. When they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary, his mother, and fell down and worshiped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented unto him gifts of gold and frankincense and myrrh. The wise men departed into their own country, and the shepherds also returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen. And the child was called Jesus, which was so named by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. Would you join me in prayer? Dear God, thank you for helping us to imagine what it was like when Jesus was born. Thank you for all the pictures that help us to see Mary and Joseph and the angels. We know your love is everywhere in the world. Help us this Christmas to see your light in every corner and in every person. Amen.
Oh. O holy night, the stars are brightly shining. It is the night of our dear Savior's birth. On this holy night, when we gather to hear the story, our story, when we gather to sing our favorite carols, as we gather together, wherever we are invited to take a deep breath and to prepare ourselves for a conversation with our Savior. I invite you tonight to breathe in Christ's deep peace as we pray our Christmas prayer. Holy God, on this holy night, we gather as those who are weary from the journey. We gather with anticipation and expectation. We gather to hear our story, the story of how you, most holy God, how you came to dwell among us in the birth of your Son, Jesus Christ. On this night, we thank you, O God. Thank you for entering into this world, a world that is weary. Let your light and your love shine especially on those who are experiencing darkness. Thank you for being our source of strength, healing, and peace. We come with gratitude as we look forward to the glimpses of God's grace that we will witness on Christmas morning, be it in a smile on a child's face or the voice of a loved one on the phone. On this most holy night, may we recognize your light, even as we light candles together. May we be reminded that your light is one which darkness cannot overcome. We pray this night for the sick, the hungry, the poor, the scared. We pray for families who are missing being together, and for those who grieve the death of a loved one. We pray for a world that is weary, and we give thanks because tonight there is a thrill of hope, and we are invited to rejoice. May we listen for the angels' voices, proclaiming that Christ is born. Christ is born. Wherever we are this night, we open our hearts to the strong and powerful, just and merciful, gentle and compassionate love of our Lord Jesus Christ. And now together we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you. 2020 has been an unprecedented year. As we approach its end, we pause this night to worship God, who came to us in a lowly baby, born in a cattle shed to a mother and a father who were displaced travelers. This God of the universe, this God who created everything, this God that calls us all beloved, took on human flesh and lived among us so that we might know the height, the breadth, and the depth of God's love more fiercely than we could ever imagine. Because of this love, which we call grace, we have an obligation to continue Christ's work in the world as the church. And this is what we do here at First Presbyterian. We love because Christ taught us to love. We love our community, we love metropolitan Richmond, and we love the world. We love the students at Henry O. Marsh Elementary School and at Gilpin Court families through STEP, and we love Armstrong High School students, and we love Caritas clients, and we love the Central Moravian Church and School in Bluefields, Nicaragua, among so many other partner organizations. We love because Christ taught us to love. And again, by grace, we trust that our love breaks down walls of division, lines of segregation and oppression, and creates new ways we might truly be one, even in the face of unprecedented times. FPC has shown up to be love in mighty ways. This year, we gave over $100,000 to COVID relief and support. We gave away $90,000 through our Community Partner Grants Program, and our support of our denomination, the Presbyterian Church USA, has enabled transformative ministry in all 50 states and around the world. We have been love. We have been the hands and feet of Christ wherever we are, despite these unprecedented times. And so on this night, if we were together in the sanctuary, we would take up our yearly emergency assistance offering. This offering enables your pastors to distribute emergency funds to church members and members of our community who are in crisis. Last year, we were able to assist over 50 families who are in crisis, and we continue to receive requests for assistance every day. This fund also assists the ministry of our partner, ACTS, who works with people in crisis all over Richmond through financial empowerment. And although we are not able to be together this Christmas, you still have the opportunity to support this pivotal ministry of our church. Back in November, you received a stamped envelope which you could return to the church with your emergency assistance offering enclosed within it. And if you haven't given your emergency assistance offering gift, you can head to the church website to give that now. Finally, because of the grace, the love we know in Jesus Christ, we are all invited to make our yearly pledge covenant. We are so close to our goal, and every dollar matters so that we might continue our strong tradition of inspiring faith in Jesus Christ, nurturing disciples of Christ, and serving the world God loves to the glory of God. We do this because of that baby, that Christ child we welcome in to the world again this night, that baby who brought love to us so that we might love the world. Thank you for all the ways that you give.
I've heard about this baby boy who's come to earth to bring us joy, and I just want to sing this song to you. It goes like this, the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major lift. With every breath I'm singing, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Expecting child, they searched the inn to shepherds left their flocks by night to see this baby wrapped in light. A host of angels led them all to you. It was just as the angel said, you'll find him in a manger bed. Emmanuel and Savior, hallelujah.
Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah.
As we prepare to hear God's word read and proclaimed, let us pray. Holy God, on this Christmas night, as we prepare to hear again the story of Christ's birth, we pray that you would open our hearts and touch our souls with this great good news. In Christ's name we pray, amen. Our reading tonight comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 2, verses 8 through 20. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen as it had been told them. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Like many others this fall, I fell in love with two Netflix series about queens, The Crown and The Queen's Gambit. The Crown follows the reign of Queen Elizabeth II, dramatizing historical events. The fourth season, released this fall, covers the 1970s and 80s, when Margaret Thatcher became Britain's first female prime minister, and Prince Charles married Diana Spencer, who became the Princess of Wales. The Queen's Gambit tells the story of a chess prodigy named Beth Harmon, who was orphaned at 9 years old and sent to a home for girls, where she learned chess from the janitor and developed an addiction to tranquilizers. Despite their differences, both The Crown and The Queen's Gambit are actually about the same thing, and it's not queens. It's family. Both ask us to consider what makes a family. What does it mean to be family? And what do we do when our families disappoint us? We gather this evening to celebrate not just the birth of Jesus, but God's new creation of the human family. Jesus was born into a family of the usual sort, which is to say, a family that was more than a little messy and which brought together some unexpected members. Jesus' cousin was John the Baptist, a wilderness preacher who wore animal skins, ate locusts and wild honey, and announced the coming of the Messiah. Jesus' parents were Mary, who became unexpectedly pregnant, and Joseph, who agreed to still marry her even though the baby wasn't his. But tonight is the night we learn there is more to this family than blood and promises. Because the story we heard tells us that on this night, the angel announced Jesus' birth to a group of shepherds in the fields, keeping watch over their flocks by night. Most of us are so familiar with this story and its many depictions in literature and art and nativity sets that we fail to realize how remarkable it is that the angel appears to shepherds. At that time, shepherds were some of the lowliest members of society. They tended to be poor and illiterate. Because they often grazed their flocks on other people's property, they were viewed as dishonest. Along with sailors, butchers, and camel drivers, shepherds were the outcasts of polite society. Yet it is shepherds to whom the angel announces the birth of the Christ child. And the angel does more than just sing this news in a blaze of angelic glory, but also invites the shepherds, these outcasts, to be part of this new family born this night. To you, yes, even to you, the angel says, is born this day a Savior, the Messiah, the Lord. And if to the lowly shepherds, then indeed to us all. By including shepherds in this family, it is as if God announces, behold, you, all of you, are family. You are on the same team. You belong to one another. And I am with you to bring you and hold you together. A couple of fraught years into Charles and Diana's marriage, they went on a tour of Australia and New Zealand, taking along their infant son, William. In the episode of The Crown that dramatizes this event, we see the tour get off to a rocky start, but it becomes a resounding success as huge, adoring crowds show up wherever the royal couple goes. At one point during the tour, Charles and Diana have a heart-to-heart that gets them past their conflicts. But by the end, their relationship has once again deteriorated. And as soon as they return to England, Charles goes back to his mistress. Depressed but determined, Diana requests a meeting with the Queen to tell her she's struggling and to ask for her help.
Because since I've joined this family, it's not been easy. I've been given no help, no support, just thrown in the deep end, and I think that people out there can sense that I've suffered, that I'm undervalued, ignored.
I think it's a mistake to assume that people are feeling any sympathy for us at all.
And I think it's a mistake to assume they don't. You've seen how the crowds responded to me in Australia, here too, and instead of resenting me for it...
I assure you, no one resents you.
Charles resents me. Anne resents me, and is it possible that you resent me too? All I want is to play for the team.
You're the Princess of Wales, so of course you're part of the team.
Then show me. This whole thing, it starts and stops with you. You're the captain of the team. If you show me love, approval, and acceptance, everyone else will follow.
I think we've gone as far as we can for now. We can continue another time.
Oh, don't dismiss me, please. Don't push me away.
What?
Mama. That's all I want. It's all any of us want from you. Is it too much to ask?
Although she is a newcomer to this royal family, Diana knows how families work. It is the head of the family who sets the tone. You're the captain of the team, Diana tells the queen. If you do it, the rest will follow. But at least in matters of family relationships, the queen is reluctant to accept that role and responsibility. Not so the King of Kings, whose birth we celebrate this night, our God, who, born to peasants in a forgotten corner of the world, reveals a new kind of power and glory. In Jesus, we learn that God's strength, true strength, is revealed not in political power or military might, but in vulnerability and compassion, in the recognition that human beings, that we need one another. Jesus' life reveals to us God's expansive embrace of the world by redefining family. Beginning with the shepherds and continuing throughout Jesus' ministry with the disciples and all those on the margins with whom he spends his time, Jesus teaches us that no matter who we are, we belong in this family. We belong to each other. If the crown's depiction of Diana's reception, or lack thereof, into the royal family is a lesson in what damage is done when we reject the outsider, the queen's gambit offers the opposite lesson. What can be achieved when we show up for one another, even and especially the marginalized and the suffering? In the Queen's Gambit, Beth Harmon becomes a great chess player because she is brilliant and talented. But she becomes a champion because of all the people who help her along the way. The janitor and her friend Jolene at the orphanage, her adoptive mother in Kentucky, a series of mentors she meets in various competitions. But every time Beth gets close to someone, her discomfort with vulnerability and the unprocessed grief and trauma she carries leads her to reject relationships and seek refuge in pills and alcohol. After winning the U.S. championship, Benny, the player she defeated for the title, offers to help Beth prepare for the next big tournament in Paris, but only if she stops drinking. After weeks as Benny's student, Beth goes to Paris and makes it to the final match against the Russian world champion. But the night before, she succumbs to her addiction and then loses the match. Back home in Kentucky, she is rescued from a days-long bender when Jolene shows up, helps her get sober, and lends her the money to go to Moscow to play for the title of world champion. At this point, Beth has alienated all the players who helped her along the way, and she travels to Moscow alone. In match after match with the Russian greats, she sees that what Benny told her was true. The Russians win because they play together as a team. They help each other out. Us Americans, Benny had told her, we work alone because we're all such individualists. We don't like to let anyone help us. Amazingly, in the tournament, Beth keeps winning, and in the final round, again, faces the Russian champion who beat her in Paris. Their match goes on for so long, they have to adjourn overnight. This is when Beth is at her most vulnerable, most likely to give in to her addiction. But on her way to her hotel room, Beth runs into Towns, one of her former competitors and friends who was a casualty of her fierce independence. What are you doing here? She asks him. But even before he answers, it's clear he's come to support her, having moved mountains to get himself there.
Her relief is overwhelming. A friend she was sure she had lost has found her just when she needed him most. The next morning, Towns wakes Beth so she can prepare for the rest of the match. Then the phone rings.
Hello?
If he goes for the knight, hit him with the king rook pawn.
Any?
If he goes for the bishop, do the same thing, but open up your queen file.
How do you know?
It's in the Times.
7 a.m. here, but we've been working on it for 3 hours.
Oui?
Hi, Beth.
Hi, Harry. It's really nice to hear your voice.
Oh, hang on.
Hey, Harry! It's
Mike! We're so proud of you.
Okay, there are three things you might do now. So after the queen to knight 3, you play knight to king 6. Then if he plays rook to rook 5, then you play pawn to king 3. Another variation, if he plays knight takes pawn on king
3. In the birth of Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us, a helpless baby greeted by stable animals and shepherds, we learn that again and again, God transcends time and space to show up for us, to draw alongside us in the mess and muck and mire of our lives, to remind us that no matter how much it feels like we have lost at the game of life, we too have a place in this human family. The family God brings together, a family of winners and losers, royals and peasants, insiders and outsiders, all of us infinitely and unconditionally loved by the God of the universe. The announcement to the shepherds is for all of us, to you, is born this night a Savior, the Messiah, the Lord. With these words, we become family, whoever we are. And this is not just an announcement, but an invitation. For the members of this family are not defined by our differences. In this family, God's family, we all play for the same team. Despite all the ways we hurt and betray and reject one another, and we do this again and again in a myriad of ways, we are invited by the head of our family to draw alongside one another, to show up for one another, to be vulnerable with one another about our fear and our grief and our need, and to respond to one another with compassion and love. Christmas is when we learn again, no matter what, God shows up for us. As we gaze at the child born for a broken and hurting world, may we find the courage to show up for each other. Amen.
Schläft einsam vor.
Together, we are the family of God. May we go into the world God loves to love God's people. And as you go, may the light of Christ's star guide your way. May the love of God enfold every gift you give and receive. And may the communion of the Holy Spirit cross time and space to bring us and keep us together, whoever and wherever we are. Amen.